A video last evening went by that showed Union Minister Piyush Goyal addressing a webinar and saying pretty much what a lot of people have been thinking, that for the real estate sector to actually recover, they will have to sell. And the only way they're going to sell is if they drop rates. We are now in a situation where every industry is coming to a realization that this is a new world. In the post-COVID era, we are going to have lower demand and we're going to have to push more aggressively. Now, the real estate sector, interestingly, has asked for massive bailouts from the government. None have been received as of now. So the advice coming from a union minister saying that don't wait for us to bail you out, start selling all the inventory you're stuck with, has resonated quite a bit. So what's the reality of the situation? Are real estate developers and people in the sector sitting tight and holding on to prices as they famously have for the last many, many years? Or has there already been some kind of a correction? To get us a clearer picture on this, I'm speaking today at Hiranjan Hiranandani, co-founder and MD of the Hiranandani Group. I'm also joined by Vinod Rohira, MD and CEO of Commercial Business K. Raheja Ko, and of course, Anuj Puri, chairman of Anarock Property Consultants. Welcome, gentlemen. Great to have you on the show today. Niranjan, you were in that webinar where Union Minister Piyush Goyal made no bones about what the truth was. He was pretty frank. It was brutal. But I think it was an important message, isn't it? That, you have to be Atmanirbhar. You have to drop your rates and sell your inventory. That's the only way.
I think Mr. Piyush Goyal is a very wise man. And so is Mr. Deepak Parekh. And so is Mr. Uday Kotak. If you haven't seen his note, he concurs with what Mr. Piyush Goyal has said yesterday. But you have to understand the context with which they were talking. Because there are developers who have taken huge amount of loans from the banks and financial institutions and are holding on to assets in order for the prices to come back again or to push it up again. And that is the context in which he said, for God's sake, don't keep the loans on and wait for some kind of a carrot to come from the government and then go for selling it, bring down the prices and be able to do it. I thought it was a very sensible statement on his part, except for the fact that in reality, the prices have already come down and they can't be brought down more legally because Section 43C or A of the Income Tax Act gives you such a huge penalty, unbelievable. I wouldn't pay it. Nobody, no person in his senses would pay that penalty, which is 35% of the difference of the redirectional rate and the rate at which you are doing. And until that section is not done, what Mr. Piyush Goyal wants and what I want to do also cannot be done legally. So we don't know how to do that. So we requested Mr. Piyush Goyal to approach the finance minister in order to make the provisions change. And once that is done, I'm sure the prices will come down in many places, especially those people who have borrowed the monies.
You know, Mr. Hiranandani, I want to believe, honestly, that your intention is, and when I say you, I mean the real estate sector, is really waiting in the wings to drop prices, but is being held back by a technicality. Is that really the picture? I'm not so sure. I just want to put some data. This is actually Anuj's data that shows that compared, Q1 2020 and Q1 2019, that's the data that Anarock has put out, has shown the sales dip by close to 50%, 35 to 50%, depending on which region, while prices have changed between 0 and 1%. So your sales have dropped significantly, but prices have not changed. Anuj, am I quoting this data correctly? Can you explain the data to us before I get a response?
Yeah, absolutely, Tamanna. So, you know, a little unfair, Tamanna, because, you know, Q1 of 2020 was the period where COVID had started to hit.
So this the is, nervousness... you're counting calendar year, January.
Calendar year, that's right.
So, Anuj, COVID hit us in our, in, you know, in our minds and once the lockdown started, which was honestly, I would give you the last 10 days of March.
Yeah, I think it started really mid-February onwards, Tamanna. You know, many of the site visits were not happening. People had started to become nervous. You know, Europe had gone big time into COVID. So really what you got was the 1.5 months starting from January to mid-February. After mid-February, the site visits had dropped significantly. And clearly after 15th of March, we just didn't have any site visits. So the data is correct, what you're saying. I'm just putting a little bit of color to it that because of the COVID, the site visits just didn't happen post mid of February.
No, that's fine. It is data comparing the first quarter of this year, Jan, Feb, March, to the year before.
Correct.
We know real estate sector has been in trouble long before COVID hit. There has been a slew of problems starting right from demonetization. The history is well known to anyone who tracks the sector and truly anyone. So demand has fallen. It's been falling consistently. Prices have not fallen. There's the data to show it. Right? The data is there to show it. Prices have not fallen. Mr. Hiranandani, when you say prices have fallen, what do you mean? By what extent have prices really fallen? And since when?
If you take the demonetization time and the period beginning with the COVID situation, they're down between 10 to 15% across the board in most of the cases that have taken place. Of course, there are cases where even the prices may have gone up, but those are rare instances that you will see. If you compare the prices with the ready reckoner rate, there are so many of the transactions which have taken place even lower than the ready reckoner rates all over the country, including the Mumbai region. So I don't think the fact is entirely correct, because I've seen these transactions where the lower prices sales have also taken place. But I think what we are talking about is some sort of an average rate, which may not be correct. Because if you take a strong player, let's say Godrej, for instance, or Tata Housing, for instance, or some strong players that you do, and you average it out with other players who have actually dropped the prices, you can't really get a fair story. So to say that prices have not fallen across the board, I think, Tamanna, would be totally incorrect. To say yes, that many of the good players who have not got strong, who have not got big borrowings from the banks, are holding on to the prices, it's quite possible. But let me put a small correction to what you're saying. 1.1 crore houses are being constructed under the affordable housing scheme of the Government of India, of which 65 lakh of those across the country are in the construction mode that has taken place. Of course, it doesn't include Mumbai region, or it doesn't include the Delhi region, because Delhi, anyway, you have got too many apartments at a lower cost price, affordable price, that you don't need to have any more on the affordable hand. But if you see the rest of the country, the affordable housing segment has definitely grown. And those are definitely pinpointed at lower price. The GST is at 1%. The interest subvention is 3%. So at a 7% interest rate housing loan borrowing, the party is paying only 4% for the next 15 years.
That's the interest. I'm not talking about the interest. I'm talking about the prices. Let me come back to the, you know, key and the crux of the conversation. Vinod Roy Ram, I want to bring you in here. I'm saying that we know that prices have been softening, but have they softened enough? The point that Mr. Goyal was making very clearly was, right now, in the post-COVID scenario, we know real estate is in a bad shape. We don't know when demand is going to come back, when people are going to want to buy more houses, etc. It's already been in trouble for a while. His prescription seems to be that look inwards, reduce the prices further. We've been seeing that across sectors. Across sectors, people who have stock, companies that have stock, are finding ways to discount it. Why should it be different in the real estate sector?
Okay, so I'll just take a step back, right? I started my career way back in 96. And I remember selling in 95 as a trainee, apartments in Warsaw at 9,000 rupees a square. And in 2000, that apartment was 3,500 rupees a square. We have seen only two peaks. Rest of the 8, 9, 10 years, which we believe is slump, is actually normal. And like you rightly said some time ago, that real estate in the past 5 years has been hit by demon, GST, and a whole lot of slew of things, RERA, exit, et cetera, et cetera, that has taken place to that industry. So whatever price corrections were to take place have steadily been getting adjusted to demand. and supply at the same time had gone up. So you have seen significant supplies go up in the last 5 years. And you've seen, because of that supply, price takers coming back and it moving from a developer market to a consumer's market. So already before COVID hit, like Anuj mentioned, the markets were already at their bottom. With costs going up on the other end, replacement costs to these assets were going to become difficult. You were seeing capital not available from NBFCs. So who was going to finish projects? Customers were too scared to come and buy anyway under construction projects. So by default, you would see only those people who were putting in capital to complete projects would see traction of sales. And those guys would not want to discount pricing because the risk was far lower. Consumers were willing to buy. Whereas you were brochure supply, at any price will not sell because consumers have become far more intelligent. So you have a mixture. In each micro market, you will have five buildings with different prices. Having said that, even today, if a consumer comes to buy, you will get a price. Because those who are tight for cash flow will sell for cash flow. Those who aren't tight for cash flow will sell for the right price for the product, for replacement cost of that asset. So it's difficult to say what is right price, honestly. It really depends.
No, it's very simple to say what is the right price. I mean, the price is a discovery of the market, right?
Yeah.
So you're saying that since there are no customers, why should I lower the price?
No, I'm saying differently. Each product in a micro market has to be treated independently, differently. It's depending upon what your cash flow needs are, what the pricing is. And Mr. Hiranandani also mentioned to you, we have in specifically in Bombay, the ready reckoner rates that become a threshold, you can't sell below that, right? Now, we understand that if the prices have to be further discounted, we have to work with governments to make sure that those numbers are adjusted for if they were overpriced from a market point of view. And this is not a COVID story. This is happening for the last 1 year or 2 years. We're seeing certain markets where reckoner prices are higher or at the threshold of market prices. And that was a need to correct anyways. So okay. There are many aspects.
So let me recap. So if ready reckoner prices come down, then prices can be lowered. Anuj, I want to again take that at face value that the industry badly wants to lower prices, but you know, there are technicalities holding them back. Tell me, will that bring in demand then? And to what extent do you see the need to soften prices to get customers back in? We know right now that interest rates are heading lower. Yeah?
So, absolutely, Tamanna. So I'll answer it in two parts. You know, one is, Tamanna, you are actually speaking with very strong developers, you know, whether it's Rahejas or Niranjan Bhai or, you know, Oberoi or, you know, DLF or Godrej or Tata's, the names that they've taken. You know, they are unlikely to bring down the price, Tamanna. They have the holding capacity. They don't have the debt. So I agree with what Niranjan Bhai is saying is that, you know, there will be a differentiation between developers and developers. There will be developers who will bring down the price. My only worry is, Tamanna, we've been saying is that bring down the price. My worry is that many of these developers will bring down the price, but would they have the capability to complete the project having dropped the price? I'm not so sure. So, you know, I just want to make sure that the buyer really understands that it is not only a discussion about reduction in the price. Ask anyone, pick up listed balance sheets of the developers. They are at a single percentage margin that they are really operating at this moment in time. So I'm saying is that the dialogue can become very risky, that if it becomes too much reduction in the price, my fear is that that money of the developer is actually going to his lender rather than in cement and steel at the building. Very, very careful. Second is, has the price come down? I'm saying, Tamanna, even if it did not come down and it remained the same over the last, say, 3-4 years, you know, the inflation at 5%, if you were to take it up and it had remained the same, you know, that itself means is that it's cheaper today by 20% than what it was earlier.
I'm sorry, I must come in there because, you know, we have to take into consideration your post-COVID realities. Right now, in the real world, people's incomes have come down, right? You're a salaried employee, is likely you've either lost your job or your income has come down. If you run a business, your incomes have come down, your margins have come down. For entire families, that has happened in units. Businesses have, you know, lost money. People are right now renegotiating their rentals. They're renegotiating everything that they pay out, right? even to the extent of school fees are being renegotiated. So in this case, if you're going to give me the 3 years, me dekho inflation kitna bada argument, it's not really cutting eyes.
So Tamanna, they will be, as I said earlier, there will be developers who will drop it, there will be developers who will not drop it. To generalize that everybody is going to drop it, I mean, there are people who are on the screen, they have ability to hold it easily for the next 12, 18 months. So unlikely that we will see that there is going to be a generic drop in the prices. All that I was trying to make a point is that, you know, these prices drop if it is significant. I'm just wanting to make sure that your viewer understands that project may become risky for them to invest, particularly if it is under construction, because I'm not sure at a single digit percentage margin that the developers have an ability to bring down the prices hugely.
Now, what about unsold inventory? What about ready unsold inventory? Okay, Mr. Hiranandani, I want to first respond to a couple of points Anuj made. He's made a distinction between grade A, developers and the rest. We're also seeing a trend over the last few years where buyers have become very conscious about where they put their money. They're willing to spend a little more, but go with grade A, where they know that the project will be completed, they'll get quality, et cetera, and, you know, main thing is completion of the project. So first point, he says 12 to 18 months holding capacity exists with those in the grade A category. Is that the case? And is it prudent then to hold on?
No, that's a case of merit. And he's correct that projecting the case, Anuj is right, that they have the innate capacity to do it. But just like the king of Saudi Arabia cannot control the price of oil, no developer can actually control what Vinod Rohira just told you, control the price of real estate. So all this talk about the builders being too strong and not keeping the price up beyond the capacity to do it is not in reality. Let's talk real sense. The real sense is the law prohibits you to reduce it more than 10% of the ready reckoner rate. In 97% of the cases, it's already happened. Where's the question of doing it? It's a theoretical possibility that you must reduce the rate. I agree with you. Let us reduce the rate. Can you actually reduce the rate? The answer is no. If you cannot reduce the rate legally because the income tax will penalize you for reducing it, then isn't it a theoretical proposition, Tamanna, that you say reduce the rate and don't you think it's a good thing to do the rate? So while I agree with you, I agree with you that we should reduce the rate, especially in the case where developers have borrowed monies. It is wrong to over-leverage on public money, as has been done in many of the cases. In one case, the Supreme Court has even appointed me as a director of one of the companies. And it has happened. So it is wrong for them to over-leverage and then hold on to the price. But the rest of it, the market will determine the price in the next couple of months to be done. And you are right. You will get affordable housing in a very large way. But you may not get it across the board, as Anuj Puri just mentioned to you. It won't be across the board. But yes, it will happen. And you will see a large number if happen. But if you want it, the government has to change the law or change the ready reckoner rate. Are they ready for it? We are ready.
Okay, so that's very clear. Change the ready reckoner rate. You know, Mr. Hiranandani, I think you're very good at chess as well, along with your business of development, because what the builders actually want is that the ready reckoner rate should come down. So he's saying you do that and then we'll start lowering. Mr. Rohira, you agree that the only hitch between the true intention of all developers who are dying to reduce prices is just this one technicality, and the moment it's out of the way, prices will drop. If so, by how much?
See, I've always maintained, irrespective of what your ready reckoners are, if there is a customer, there will be a sale. To bring the customer back, firstly, I'd just like to add what Anuj said also earlier. The consumer who's losing his job is not the guy who's going to come and buy a house anymore. He's out of the demand cycle completely.
Yeah.
There are people who retain their jobs in this COVID environment will be far more confident 6 months later that the doomsday is over, blue sky is returning back. I don't want to be stuck in a rented accommodation where I have to cough out money. Let me buy an apartment. Let me have my own security and asset as a big learning. So I think just like people will buy a car or a bike instead of traveling in trains and buses, they will end up buying homes instead of living in rented accommodation. So there might be a demand shift that might take place. Otherwise, the millennials were known for wanting to live a vagabondish life, living in a rented accommodation as single adults. they're going to move to say, let me have a stable asset base. So you might see a demand curve shift out. You can never know till sentiment doesn't come back. If sentiments come back, real estate will bounce back. And then you will say, what happened to pricing or what happened to supply? You've seen that in 2008 and 2009. You will see that again. We just have to navigate the fog for the next 3 to 6 months till the fear moves out of our minds and hearts. The minute the fear moves out, are we saying demand's gone away? No. Supply has definitely gone away. So by default, if let's fast forward 9 months, where your fear of COVID is either overcome or you moved on with the new normal and your jobs are secure and you're moving on. What are you going to do next? The supply is going to be 50% of what it was. No new launches will happen. There's no capital available. There's no labor available. Construction costs have gone up. What will you do? You will take risk-averse decisions. You will go towards projects which are pouring concrete, completing on time, assuring you delivery, and are backed up by great institutions. You will pay that premium to buy that house if you decide to pay and buy the house. House is not like a window shopping impulse exercise. You're taking the decision, you have the ability and the desire to buy. Only then will you go and sit on the counter. So that's a sale in your mind already concluded. Then you'll go and seek a price. So it's got nothing to do with this. Right now, there's so much uncertainty. As human beings, we hate uncertainty. At this point in time, if I tell you I'm giving you at 50% somewhere, will you go and buy the house you want? How many people have free liquid capital available to go and invest in a house just because they want to buy a house? Somebody who needs a house is still buying. Correct me if I'm wrong, Anuj. Somebody who needs a house, even today, I'm seeing transactions take place. So it's really sentiment driven. You see how the sentiment moves, you'll see the demand move.
Yeah, Anuj, you want to come in on that? It'll depend a lot on the sentiment and looking at this trend. I don't think anyone's in any hurry to drop prices.
So Tamanna, it is interesting. I mean, the data that we've got collected post the lockdown in Bangalore City, which was the first one that has come up in there, we're back to 65% of the transaction volume already in that city. Now, that city is unique because it has IT. Perhaps job losses didn't happen in IT, you know, perhaps social distancing is maintained. It's very cosmopolitan. It was the first city to have opened up. So maybe it's a wrong example, but we are surprised. And, you know, when we look at the data that came in from China as well, Tamanna, they used to sell 5,000 homes pre-COVID a day. They were back in April to 3,000 homes a day, 60% of that is. So who knows where the consumer sentiment, where the thought processes, as Vinod said, is, you know, it may be quite possible is that many guys, you know, who lived in rented accommodations, who were perhaps treated very differently by the building societies as a tenant versus a landowner, may actually start to think is that, you know, it's great that I go out and buy. My spouse has been saying, my parents have been saying, you know, the interest rates are lower in an uncertain environment. It may be a good decision to actually have a physical asset in hand. So I would say is that at this point in time, very difficult to judge which side of the pendulum this is going to be.
I mean, I know you have to be optimistic about what's happening in your sector, but this imaginary customer of yours is almost sounding like a mythical creature to me today. I mean, I must be honest. Who's sitting and saying, wow, let me now take a 20-year loan and tie myself to EMIs when I don't know what happened to the world in the last 6 months. I hope it happens. For the economy, I hope it happens.
And Tamanna, it is amazing, huh? When you look at the Bangalore data, and hopefully in the next few weeks, you will get to see that. It is just amazing that they have actually gone ahead and done it. I'm surprised as well that 65%, and you'll see many of the listed guys who will declare their results on 30th of June. Yeah, you'll see that the sales that they've been able to do, the Bangalore listed guys.
Okay, so Bangalore people are buying because maybe work from home. Mr. Hiranandani, we've talked about this before. You think work from home is going to shift the paradigm? You know, bad for commercial real estate, maybe a little better for residential real estate. And somewhere along the line, whoever can will have to become a little more flexible on pricing.
I think you're right. There is going to be a change. So one thing is certain that post-COVID, there are going to be lots of people who want to work from home, who wants probably one bedroom extra for their houses. And on the other hand, many of the commercial offices also are promising social distancing in their office. So they may actually, even though the work from home is there, they may still want the larger offices in order to keep the social distancing happening. But as both of the Roira and Anuj both mentioned, all this is terrible, looks horrible at the present. when we are in the midst of a crisis, but once you come out of the crisis and the going becomes normal, or whatever you may call the new normal, you will see that the people's expectation and desire to buy a house is definitely going to come back. We have seen it happen 7 times in my lifetime. And every time when it is down, we think it's doomsday. Nothing is ever going to come back again. And it's merry after 6 to 12 months after that story. So Tamanna, while I agree with you 100% that the mood in Mumbai is still down, but look at the story about the kind of COVID story which is taking place today. So it's unfair to really predict the future in these doomsday time in Mumbai. But as Anuj correctly pointed out, look at the Bangalore story, and soon you will see the Mumbai story also go in the same way.
No, no, but, clearly, this is not only about Mumbai.
There is one rider. One rider I'd like to put. But yes. The rider is, if India does not grow well, then obviously the story of real estate will also not grow as strong. But if Mr. Modi, the Prime Minister Modi, is able to successfully turn the economy to a positive innings and move it to a positive side where we have 3, 4, 5% GDP growth, real estate will also boom, both commercial and residential. But you can't see it today. I can quite understand. We are at the bottom of the pit covered by COVID clouds, which are taking place. So I don't see any. So don't worry about the future.
Clouds, they'll give us a skip. But you know, the story is not only about Mumbai city. We have to wait and see how the story unfolds. We have to wait and see how the story unfolds with this huge reverse migration, which has also taken place. And where the economy moves next, maybe the story will move out of the big metros. So far, though, to wrap up for our viewers who may have tuned in to listen to whether, you know, the big boys of real estate are interested in dropping prices. Well, they don't seem to be cracking yet, no matter how much plain speak is put out there. We'll have to wait and see if they have that holding capacity. We'll take a very short break. When we come back, it's CEO speak time. Big, big voices on the channel today. We have that massive Salil Parekh interview, which you're going to hear. We'll also get you the best of what Uday Kotak has said today. He's taken over as CII president. And Rajiv Bajaj, who makes headlines every time he does an interview, has a very strong message as well. All of that up.